Welcome back from lunch. I'm gonna get your attention again. I love that people are still having discussions and meeting people and thinking about ideas. I'm Kara Miller. I host Innovation Hub from a national radio show from WGBH and PRI. And this first afternoon session is about cities, the increasing power of cities, the increasing relevance of cities and communities to deal with and to affect climate change. And we actually talk a lot about this issue on the show, and it's fascinating because, you know, I was talking to Adam, our first panelist, about this before I got up here, but cities are these little dots on the map. Like, how could they have so much power? And yet, over half of us now live in cities or in metropolitan areas, and that is on its way to 70% in the next few decades. So you've got mega cities, right, with 10 million people or more. So this is really an exploration of how do cities then, if they have that kind of power, how do they leverage that clout? We have seen certainly cities in the US and abroad make real impact and moves when it comes to climate change. I think of Vancouver, I think of Chicago, I think of New York, I think of Boston, which has a Green Ribbon Commission, which just had 19 sustainability leaders from around the country come in and think, okay, how do we impact the Paris climate talks? So our first speaker today comes from one of the cities I just mentioned, New York, Adam Fried, and he has worked on Plan NYC. So sort of coming off of Megastorm Sandy, asking these questions, how do you change, you know, the resilience of a city? What kind of plans do you put in place? So Adam's gonna tell us about what New York has learned in recent years and how you actually sort of get to that place of change. Adam, take it away.
Thank you. You know, I can think of a few things that are worse than actually being the first panelist after lunch as everyone is recovering from their stupor, except if you're following a number of presentations with really fun pictures of animals. So I am in a really unenviable position. So please bear with me as you get cityscapes and pie charts and maps instead. So not only did I work in New York City for 5 years leading New York City sustainability efforts, Plan YC, a far-reaching sustainability plan for New York, I then spent 2 years working at the Nature Conservancy, leading a global water program, working in 34 countries around the world, focused on cities and water. I now work at Bloomberg Associates, which is a pro bono consulting service started by former New York City Mayor Mike Bloomberg, which is giving free assistance to cities, and I lead their sustainability practice. So what I'm hoping to talk about is grounded in New York, but also looking at the city space globally, and what are some of those emerging trends you see in cities. So I want to touch on six key points. One, as Kara was saying, cities are critically important. And why are we here talking about cities? And what I hope this can be is the alternative to some of the depressing doom and gloom we heard this morning. The scale of the challenges we face is absolutely enormous. But you can also get the deer in the headlights reaction of, this is so big, there's nothing I can do, nothing good is happening. Cities have tremendous opportunity to try to address many of the risks that we're seeing. Cities are also on the front lines of climate change, so there's a reason why cities are taking action. It's not because they're enlightened citizens. I always go back to Fiera LaGuardia, who said there's no Democratic or Republican way of collecting garbage. There's no partisan response to climate change when you are actually on the front lines dealing with the flood. Cities need to be delivering. Cities have significant powers. So they're on the front lines, and there's a lot that they can do. They need other people to act. We need a carbon tax. We need a national climate agenda. We need the clean power plant rules that are going through with the EPA. We need an agreement at some point through the COP process. But cities can do a lot in the meantime. They're also solution-oriented, and I'll talk about what some of those solutions look like. Cities are learning from each other, and Kara and I were also talking about how cities are becoming networked. There is no monopoly on innovation. We steal our best ideas from other people. I'll give some examples of that. And that cities are now coming together saying we're not going to wait for others to figure out how to solve the problem that we're dealing with. They're taking collective action. So why are cities important? Imagine this is the world. That is the footprint of cities on the surface area of the planet, between 1 and 2% of the world. So imagine if we took all of you and said 70 of the 100 people here are going to come sit up in the first two seats. And that represents the city's footprint on the world. It's an enormous, enormous amount of density that's packed into cities. 50% of the world's population currently living in cities. That's going to be going up to 70% very soon. So a huge concentration of people in cities. 70% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions come from cities. So if you want to address climate change, if you want to reduce our carbon emissions, if you want to avert the 3 to 4 degrees Celsius, you need to be addressing this in cities. And 80% of global GDP comes from cities. So you want to protect cities because people are there, because our economies depend on it, and there are a lot of resources that can be brought to bear to that. So talking about cities on the front line, 90% of cities are actually coastal cities. So they are, when you think about sea level rise, when you read the papers about what's going to happen, when you think about these storms that are coming, cities are really in the direct path of that. And not only on the front lines of climate change, they're often seen as the first responders. When something goes wrong, people don't say, I want the federal government to come, I want the state to come. They're looking at what are their mayors doing? What is the police force doing? Where's the fire department to help rescue people as they're stuck in their homes? So cities really need to be not only be prepared to take action when a climate event happens, but also think about what to do proactively to mitigate that risk. And it's not just that, and this just gives you a sense of where cities are growing as well. So that's the flood risks globally. This is where the 600 fastest growing cities are. And I always like having these maps together because the areas most at risk is where you see the fastest growing cities. A lot of what we're doing in cities and a lot of what's happening globally is where we're settling and how we're developing is exacerbating our risk more so than climate change. But cities are taking a lot of actions. LA is a terrific example. Amidst of a massive drought that is coming close to crippling the agricultural economy, Los Angeles enacted an executive directive. They want to cut their per capita water usage 20% by 2017. This was announced last year. Already in August, they've seen a 13% reduction. So cities are understanding that they need to take actions. And it's not just about sea level rise and coastal floods. Heat kills more people every year on average than any other climate event. 2012, more people died from heat-related events than from hurricanes, tornadoes, lightning, and floods combined. So it's thinking about all of the risks that cities face, and there's no luxury in only facing and addressing one. I mentioned that cities have tremendous power. C40 Cities, it's a group of now 80 cities coming together to work on climate change. They map the powers that they have. This is meant to give you an example where they see where do we have budget setting power, where do we have policy power, where can we actually implement things, where do we just set the vision. And cities control or have some power over 34% of the assets and functions in cities. So not everything, but building codes, roadways, sidewalks, buses, park systems. These are things that cities can have direct impact on. So when they start focusing on those things that can impact change, a lot can happen. A great example of this, and I'm thrilled that we have people here from The Point in the New York City environmental justice community, because this is an issue that they brought to us when we were in the mayor's office. This is a map that shows pollution in the city. New York was the first city to saturate the city with street level air quality monitors. So we not only knew what the air quality was like six stories up broadly through the city, we could go block by block and understand how did it vary between neighborhoods. So that is PM2.5 in the city. All those blue dots, by doing this analysis, are buildings that burn something called number 6 heating oil. It is bunker oil, it's what cruise ships use, but they're not allowed to burn it and use it within about 2 or 3 miles of the coastline because it's so bad. Yet we are allowing people to burn it and use it in their buildings. It's a very efficient fuel as well, which is the challenge. So those 10,000 buildings, less than 1% of our total building stock in the city, responsible for more PM2.5 than all cars and trucks combined. We had the power to permit those boilers and had to reissue those permits. We worked with a large variety of stakeholders, from Teamsters who didn't want to phase out oil because they wanted to be able to drive it around, to our utilities who hadn't built up the natural gas system to building owners to develop a set of rules that phased out heating oil in the city. Number six heating oil converting to cleaner burning fuels. This is what our air quality looked like in the winter of 2008 and 2009. This is what it looked like last year by phasing out heavy heating oil. By looking at 10,000 buildings using the powers we had, we now have the cleanest air quality in New York City in over 50 years. We can only say 50 years because that's as long as we've kept records. This is just one program that we're going to phase out heating oil in 4 years. The second largest public health initiative in New York City, second only to the smoking ban. Cities also have tremendous control and power over the public right of way. And this is a great example where many cities, people say it can't happen there. Cities are proving that you can replicate these ideas. Times Square, we wanted to find a way to decrease pedestrian conflicts and fatalities, to improve the air quality. And cities are nimble and able to move quickly. So we actually, and that's an important thing, as a pilot, we said, let's shut down Times Square and turn it into this. A couple cans of paint, movable chairs, and stones. We were able to pedestrianize Times Square. We saw traffic flows actually increase because we were decreasing conflicts with pedestrians. We saw fatalities decrease and accidents decrease. Air quality improved, ground rents improved, retail sales improved. And this has now moved from a pilot to something we piloted in many other communities throughout New York and have permanently closed Times Square and done major capital improvements. And you see this now replicating in other places. Mexico City, where we've been doing work at Bloomberg Associates. This leads into the Zucalo, the main square in Mexico City, has now been pedestrianized. You see this as well in Buenos Aires, where you're able to add BRT and retake some of the public space. We stole these ideas from Medellin and Bogota, in areas that took streets that looked like this, and with paint and very little improvements, dramatically improved the availability of public space, reduced the amount of reliance on cars, which reduces your carbon emissions. Cities are also solution-oriented. And in New York, we have a big problem where for every inch of rain the city gets, it's 1 billion gallons of stormwater. 1 billion gallons of stormwater that we need to capture, collect, transport, treat before we release it into our waterways. Because if we don't, we're out of compliance with the EPA Clean Water Act. 800 cities in the U.S. are out of compliance with the Clean Water Act because they're not able to capture their stormwater. It mixes with their sewer system. It goes into your riverbeds. It goes into your waterways, and it causes pollution. The old adage, don't go swimming the day after it rains, there's a reason for that. This is the traditional response. You build a giant tunnel underground. You store the water there. It's locked off to the community, so now you can't get to the waterfront. It doesn't serve any purpose other than when it rains. It's expensive. It takes a lot of energy to operate when it happens. We've gone from this type of solution to spending $2.2 billion on this, which is green infrastructure, where you're saturating the city with planted areas, the rooftops. We have 1.6 billion square feet of rooftops in New York, one of the great underutilized resources. How do we use that to harness and capture stormwater in a way that can reduce our carbon emissions, increase air quality, increase recreation opportunities? And this is not just New York now. You're seeing it replicated in places like Kansas City, places like Detroit, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, which has also been leaders on this, creating a better quality of life for residents. It's cheaper than gray infrastructure, and it helps us address the climate problems on the mitigation side and adaptation so we can prevent flooding. Cities are also learning from each other, and cities are, as I said, great at copying each other. We always joke that we stole some of our best ideas from other cities. We had a very, very good relationship with places like Philadelphia and Boston, where we would do something in New York, they would do it even better. We would then leapfrog and try to get ahead of them. We had a Million Tree campaign in New York where we actually planted 1 million trees. Boris Johnson, soon after that, announced a 2 million tree program. Which we joked that we were going to create triple-decker buses in New York just to continue the one-upmanship. So this is Curitiba, Latin America, where they created bus rapid transit. They didn't need to build a new subway line to vastly increase how people can get around, decrease reliance on cars. Very quickly, it went to Bogota, and you saw it happening there. The largest and most rapid expansion of BRT now is in Rio de Janeiro. 30% of the carbon emissions come from the transportation sector. being able to give people an alternative to a car reduces congestion, reduces GHG emissions. And it's now happening in exotic places like Cleveland, where you're seeing bus rapid transit and the lessons learned in Latin America and elsewhere are replicating themselves. And it's happening in North-South Exchange and East-West Exchange. Cities are really coming together through networks like C40 to share best practices and to help each other accelerate the pace of change that we're seeing. And the last piece I want to end on, and this is where I really see hopefully an opportunistic, a positive story, is that cities are coming together and are not saying we're going to wait for others to take action. I was involved in 2009 in the mayor's office in C40, where we tried to get into Copenhagen. We wanted, as cities, to say, please engage us. We want to be a part of the process. A lot of activities happening. We think we can help nations meet their climate agreements because of the actions we're taking. We couldn't physically get into the Bellagio Center there. We had our own mayor summit at City Hall in downtown Copenhagen, where we tried to showcase our ideas. And that was one of the positive things that came out of Copenhagen, was a lot of recognition of the power that cities had and the actions is happening. This year, there is a special UN envoy for cities and climate change, Mike Bloomberg. Cities are a part of the Paris effort. There is an official mayor summit and state and local government leader summit that's happening, that's going to be bringing state and local leaders and mayors to Paris to talk about climate change. Mike Bloomberg is trying to convene the mayor's compact, the compact of mayors. Already 270 cities have signed on saying, we're going to disclose our carbon emissions. We're going to create a climate action plan. We're going to create a GHG emissions goal. And we're going to disclose what that is and show progress towards that publicly so people can track it and we can be taken account in when the nations are trying to come to an agreement. And I would urge those of you who are on the reporting side of things, you know, Paris is going to be very complicated. If eight of your friends tried to go out to dinner, simply getting an agreement on what restaurant to go to would take you an hour, and many people wouldn't be happy. Bring almost 200 nations together to come up with when you're going to peak on carbon, what energy sources you're going to use, who's going to pay for it, what does it mean for you, was it my fault or your fault? It's intensely complicated. Paris is not the end of the race. It's a checkpoint on the way to it. What's happening with cities and the stories that are going to be showcased on cities, and I think the power of the mayors coming together, is incredibly powerful and incredibly important. And I think it's really important to focus not only on the challenges we face, but how cities are proactively addressing these issues and showing a way that nations can follow. So, you know, I really want to focus on the fact that, you know, as cities are taking action block by block, neighborhood by neighborhood, city by city, we're witnessing a radical transformation of our built environment. And I think this is part of the story that you see is the you know, century of cities. It's a century of cities, more people are moving there, but cities themselves are changing. And it's very subtle changes, you know, invisible things like changing fuel oil that no one here notices, that has the second biggest public health impact in New York City. It's a subtle change like green infrastructure, that you may walk by a tree pit, you may walk by porous pavement, you may walk by a green roof and have no idea that is reducing floods and reducing operating costs for the cities. Two larger scale changes, that the DNA of cities in our urban environment is radically changing, improving the quality of life for citizens, helping us address climate risks by reducing carbon emissions and mitigating climate change and the risks that we face, and also creating economic opportunity. So really excited to be here, thankful for the invitation, and look forward to the discussion.
Adam, that was great. Our next presenter is also from New York, from Hunts Point in the Bronx, Angela Tovar, and she has also seen the response that, especially in the wake of Sandy, has boosted the power of cities to think about what you do about climate change. Angela, take it away.
All right. Thank you. Give it up for New York, right? I'm sure that's what everyone in Boston likes to hear all the time, right? So my name is Angela. Thank you for the intro, Kara. I'm an urban planner and a community advocate who has had the privilege in the last 5 years of working in a community called Hunts Point, which is located in the South Bronx in New York City. So I want to share with you today a little bit about our community's drive towards becoming more socially and more environmentally resilient. And what I mean by that is our ability to manage any change and any disruption caused by a climate event. So I'll share with you a little bit about our organization, the work that we do, the community that we serve. We'll talk a little bit about our discovery and how we discovered how we are climate vulnerable. And we'll talk about our activities in becoming, in securing a more climate resilient future for the South Bronx. So I'll start by talking about my community organization. It's called the Point Community Development Corporation. We are located on the Hunts Point Peninsula. For the last 21 years, we've celebrated all art and culture in a neighborhood that has been traditionally been defined by some really negative attributes, including substandard housing, failing schools, high poverty rate, and high crime rate. But the Point offers a multifaceted approach to community development, and it's all aimed at improving the quality of the life in the community and the revitalization of the neighborhood. So we have youth development programs. We engage about 500 students in grades 1 through 12 in both after-school programming and also in summer programming. We have an arts and culture program that is aimed at preserving the culture of the South Bronx and also at making art more accessible to our community. And we work on community development. So through the lens of environmental justice, we are mobilizing people on the ground in the neighborhood to discuss issues that relate to the quality of life in the community. So this is a land use map of our neighborhood. And for any of you that are urban planners, you're probably going to be scratching your head after this. But our neighborhood is comprised of three different areas, the food distribution center, the industrial core, and the residential core. The food distribution center is made up of three different markets, the Hunts Point Produce Market, the Fulton Fish Market, and the Hunts Point Meat Market as well. Collectively, they make the second largest food distribution center in the world and the largest food distribution center in the country. They feed 22 million people in the New York City metro region. In addition, combined with the industrial area, Hunts Point is an economic hub for New York City. We generate about $5 billion in economic activity annually, and we employ 25,000 people in the neighborhood. So next to the food center, so this is where the tricky part comes in. Next to the food center is the industrial area. It houses 800 food-related businesses, but in addition to that, it's also home to a wastewater treatment facility, 13 waste transfer stations, a prison barge. It's home to a slew of auto-related industries, just light manufacturing and heavy manufacturing. And together, all of these businesses are truck dependent. So we have about 15,000 to 20,000 trucks that come in and out of the community on a daily basis. In the midst of all this truck dependent industry is this residential core. The residential core is a low-income community of color. There's 13,000 people that live on the Hunts Point Peninsula. They are primarily Latino at 66%. And about 28% black or African American. So you can imagine being next to all of those pollution producing facilities and the diesel truck emissions that we've had a long history of being overburdened by this type of land use. The community suffers from high rates of asthma. We have the highest asthma rate in the country. One in three children in the neighborhood suffer from asthma. We also have sky high rates of diabetes and obesity. But we are also mobilized. We are a community that is incredibly connected to what's going on around us. We are passionate and we are working towards, through the lens of environmental justice, working towards a better quality of life. And so we organize around this idea that everyone, regardless of race or income, should have the same environmental protection and the same environmental amenities as everybody else. So this is an example of one of the projects that we've engaged in. This is one of the first times that the city tried to bring both the industry and the community together to work on the plan. We worked on something in the early 2000s with the city of New York called the Hunts Point Vision Plan. And this was sort of served as a framework to guide future planning in the neighborhood. So we, as a task force, we came up with ideas to talk about how to optimize land use, how to look at all of the toxic land in the area and how to reduce the number of brownfields that we have, how to improve the flow of traffic safety. Again, it's 15,000 trucks, that's a lot of trucks.
so how to improve traffic safety, how to create new waterfront space for the area, and because of our high unemployment rate, how to leverage jobs. The greatest outcome for us that came from this plan was something called the South Bronx Greenway. We were actually doing a ribbon cutting this weekend to celebrate the completion of the first phase of the Greenway. We've created a waterfront park, but we've also created a network of green streets, pedestrian pathways, exercise paths, and bike lanes that help connect the neighborhood to the waterfront parks that exist and also these newly created ones, but also to improve transportation safety and access in the neighborhood. So this type of proactive planning that we've been engaged in over the years led us to a partnership with a group called the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance, or NYJA. NYJA is a collective of nonprofit grassroots organizations, all that represent communities of color in New York City. So in 2010, the Bloomberg administration started looking at their comprehensive waterfront development plan and how to revise that. So at the same time, NYJA started looking at something called Significant Maritime Industrial Areas, or SMIAs. What NYJA found in their research is that, or I should say that SMIAs are areas that are, they're like clusters of land that are zoned for high manufacturing and high maritime use. So what NYJA found in their research, there are six SMIAs throughout New York City, and they found that all of the SMIAs were in storm surge zones, and that the city hadn't looked at what the risk is of having such high manufacturing zoning in a storm surge area. So really showing how vulnerable we are at our waterfronts. This is the South Bronx SMIA. It's comprised of five different neighborhoods, Hunts Point being one of them. It's this area right here. That's the Hunts Point Peninsula. This blue hatched area right here is the food distribution center. And the dots represent Superfund sites or land that, that hosts toxic substances. So you can see how climate vulnerable we are. This is the storm surge area, this orange and yellow. And you can see that these blue dots are either in the storm surge zones or in pretty close proximity, about a half a mile buffer. What's even more alarming, especially for us New Yorkers in the room, is that the food distribution center is not too far from these toxic substances here. And this, again, is the regional food distribution center that feeds about 22 million people in the New York City metro region. So about 2 years after NYJA presented this research, the worst was realized, right? Hurricane Sandy came and it hit the eastern seaboard. We were spared. We had minimal damage from Sandy, although this is a picture of some of our waterfront parks and the damage that we had. But overall, we're on the Bronx River, and the Bronx River was at low tide. Another outcome of Sandy in the neighborhood was that a wetland that had just been created in the neighborhood, this was created by a developer who said that he wanted to demonstrate how industry could embrace environmental practices. And he invested $1.5 million in years of planning and creating a wetland for the community. And it was devastated within a couple of hours. But what we learned from this process was that had the Bronx River been at high tide, it would have had a different outcome, a catastrophic outcome for both the community and for the food security of the entire region. So as a result of Sandy, the Department of Housing and Urban Development came up with a design style competition called Rebuild by Design. The idea was that they would bring developers and planners and engineers and architects from all over the world to come together to look at New York City's most vulnerable regions. Hunts Point was picked up by the University of Pennsylvania, Penn Design, and also by a group called Olin Design, which is also a landscape architecture firm in Pennsylvania. They came together to look at Hunts Point, specifically to look at how to secure the markets in the event of a future climate threat. What they got when they came to our neighborhood, what they realized was that our neighborhood is much more than just the markets. We are a community. We are a community of very passionate people, a group of stakeholders who wants to see a better future. So at the urgence of everybody in the neighborhood, they quickly hired our organization, The Point, to become one of their community partners in this process. So we were able to convene local leaders, other nonprofit organizations, community residents, business owners, to get together and to provide extensive community feedback throughout this process, and then also to encourage the Lifelines team to build off of the strengths of the community. So what we received, the outcome of this plan, is that they're going to be looking at integrated flood protection that would also serve as a greenway for everyday use for the community, looking at how to incorporate some of the social issues that we're dealing with, so where there's opportunities for training, where there's opportunities for workforce development in this process, and also looking at a microgrid. So how can we power critical infrastructure in the community that wouldn't be dependent on the grid system? So this is just a testament of what I'm talking about when I say that everybody in our delegation, in our community, kind of came together. You typically don't see this kind of synergy between the industrial community and the residential community. But our final presentation to HUD for this competition, we had 65 members of the community come together to talk about this. This is unprecedented. I mean, so most of the HUD, the other people in the competition came with just the design team. These are all people that either work or live in the neighborhood that presented the final plan to HUD. And we were awarded, through this process, we were awarded $20 million, and the city actually pitched in another $25 million to invest in some sort of infrastructure that would build off of the rebuild by design plan. So we are mobilized. We are using rebuild by design now. The point in the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance are now using Hunts Point Lifeline as a springboard to talk about climate resiliency and to see the potential in our community. We are working on a community engagement process where we're trying to connect new people to the Hunts Point Lifeline's plan and to see that the plan is accountable as it moves through the city's process. We are expanding, right? I mentioned that the SMIA is 5 neighborhoods, but we only looked at 1 through Rebuild by Design. So we're now expanding to all 5 communities in the SMIA so that we can look more comprehensively at the entire South Bronx waterfront and what the impacts are. And we are looking at how do we incorporate climate change and these concepts that we learn from Hunts Point Lifelines into the conversation beyond just this project, right? So as we're thinking about future development or future planning in the South Bronx waterfront, how do we start making sure that this is a part of that conversation? We also have extensive community engagement. We have regular community meetings. Although this is like climate change is something that probably comes very naturally to a lot of you in the room, for people on the ground that aren't scientists, some of this is really technical. And so we get together, we talk about some of these issues and what the potential is. We have a planning board that sort of keeps our process accountable and helps us look for resources and also helps us advocate on the government level. We have stakeholder meetings with other nonprofit organizations so that we can talk about how we can help build capacity for their work. And we engage our youth. So we have to keep the youth present in this conversation. We have to connect them to these ideas. And that's what we do through our youth focus groups. This is just one, this is one example of something that we've done through our community engagement process. We always talk about the South Bronx. Everyone loves to come to the South Bronx to study. It's a great case study if you're an urban planner. So we get a lot of plans that we always get plans that people plan, they put the plan on the shelf and then we don't hear about these plans ever again. So we took all of those plans out and we made an inventory of plans so that we can see where there are opportunity within these plans, right? These are some good ideas that never get implemented. So how can we take these ideas and then utilize them, right? And build off of them and incorporate them into our own resiliency agenda. In addition to that, we talk about the issues. We talk about some of the social issues and how we can leverage those issues. So as we're thinking about climate change and environmental resiliency, we're also thinking about social resiliency as well. And then we also talk about opportunities and strategies. So neighborhood residents might have some ideas on how we can become more climate resilient. How do we, so people have come up with things like building green infrastructure, building microgrids, and these are all opportunities that we want to make sure are incorporated in our larger plan. And these are just some proposed strategies that we have looking forward in the future. We are expanding our advisory board. Initially, it was just a commitment throughout the rebuild by design process, but we are asking every member of our board to stick with us for 3 more years. We want to make sure that we see this out to its full implementation. We're creating neighborhood-specific evacuation plans. We're talking a lot about climate change, and we're always talking about these big capital projects, but we need to start talking about what's going to happen tomorrow. So if a hurricane hit Hunts Point tomorrow, who's going to call who? How are we going to respond to that? Where are the supplies coming from? And how are we going to get together to address this issue? We've also created, we're in the midst of creating something called the South Bronx Community Resiliency Institute, a central meeting place so that people can talk about climate resiliency before the storm, and then after the storm, there's one place where everybody can come to the neighborhood to learn about or to react to any sort of potential climate threat. And these are just some challenges that we faced along the ways. Again, just thinking about the social resiliency, it's not just about public infrastructure or physical infrastructure. It's also about addressing some of these other issues that we can't ignore in the neighborhood. So thinking about the poverty rate, thinking about opportunities to educate people, thinking about opportunities to leverage jobs. These are all things that have to be folded in when we think about resiliency. And then there's this immediate threat of gentrification and displacement that all poor communities in the cities are feeling. So this idea that if we build all this great infrastructure and then all of these amenities come to our neighborhood, how do we ensure that these houses are preserved for the people that built the neighborhood, right? So that we're not displacing people as the land value goes up because of all of these amenities. And then also thinking about the immediate threats of climate change. What's going to happen if a storm hits tomorrow? And how can we react to that? And then as people see the need to address some of the needs of the food distribution center, that we also balance that with the needs of the community. The food security is absolutely important, and we 100% endorse the idea of obviously protecting the food security of the population, but Hunts Point is bigger than that, and it's much more than that. So just a couple of quick wins that we've had so far. The city, when the city allocated the $45 million to our project, they convened a working group that was able to get people together to start talking about how to invest that money in the community. Both Nisha and The Point were appointed to that working group, which is a win for us. So we were able to take some of these ideas that we learned through the South Bronx Community Resiliency Agenda and draw from the ideas from the community, and to be able to create implementation principles with other working group members and how to structure what that plan would look like moving forward. And those working group recommendations were sent to City Hall this September, so we're very excited and really hopeful that the plan is reflective of our community priorities. So I am going to leave it there, but I thank you for your time.
Sorry. That's okay. That was great, and one of the things I want to get into in the Q&A period, just thinking about the two talks we've heard, is this issue of when you have cities making hard choices about climate change, are there ever parts of cities that, I remember in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy, people talked about putting up seawalls, but then that would flood other areas, right? Are there ever choices that have to be made, and that's a really sort of tricky thing to get into, but... Next, let's go to Elena Letona, who is from here in Massachusetts, Central Mass. She's been working with neighbor to neighbor on social justice issues, environmental issues, and thinking about air pollution, health. Take it away.
Thank you.
No problem.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you. I want to start by thanking WGBH for this invitation. It has been an honor to be here all day long. I want to thank all the panelists that went before me. I so enjoyed your presentations, and I learned a ton. And like I told some of you during the lunch break, it was very moving to me to hear how along the very hard scientific data, there was this hard thing that was woven in your presentation. So thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here. So like I briefly mentioned yesterday at dinner, the story that I'm bringing today is a story about how a community that looks like this, that often is thought of as not connecting with climate change, as often thought of as not having power to change anything, actually came together to close the very last coal plant in the state, sited in Mount Tom, Holyoke, one of the poorest cities in the state of Massachusetts. So I want to start by telling you a little bit about who we are. Neighbor to Neighbor is a membership organization of what we call the new majority. We are comprised 100% by people of color, low income, working class, immigrants, and women. We also comprise people that span the ages of high school all the way into their 70s and even 80s. Neighbor to Neighbor, we have a passion for environmental justice and economic justice, particularly at the intersection of the two. We understand that those issues very often, if not all of the time, go hand in hand. And the way that we do our work is by using an organizing strategy at the very, very core. And our organizing strategy goes deep. We call it, we go deep in our organizing by developing leadership and by organizing the communities in the four cities where we operate, in Lynn, Worcester, Springfield, and Holyoke. And we also go broad. This we call, we also go broad in our organizing strategy because we join a bunch of other folks through our coalition and alliance work for statewide wins. And as an example, in our economic justice work, last year we were part of, and we still are, part of Raise Up Massachusetts, which brought you the highest state minimum wage in the country and earned sick time at the ballot. And in terms of our environmental justice work, we are proud members of the Green Justice Coalition, who has taken a leadership role in energy efficiency policy and implementation. We count on a core group of 50 member leaders across our four chapters. And with this core group of leaders, we are able to touch, reach out, and mobilize thousands of our neighbors. Neighbor to Neighbor is very blessed to have a C4. I don't know how many of you understand C4, C3 in the nonprofit world, but the C4 allows us to engage the electoral work directly. We can endorse candidates, we can work on their campaigns, and we can even run our own candidates. And in this last past electoral season, Neighbor to Neighbor ran 3 of our own members for local elected office. We won 2 of those campaigns. So it is a very important power building strategy that complements very well the organizing, the leadership development, and the alliance coalition work. So like I mentioned, we are very passionate about the economy and the environment and the intersection of the two. And the story that I bring today is a story of that integration. And I'm starting my story at the People's Climate March in New York City last year. I know that New Yorkers were there, but how many of us were there? Yeah. This is a delegation of Neighbor to Neighbor at the People's Climate March. And I'm starting my story here because, believe it or not, it was the very first time that I had heard the term frontline communities, a term used to denote those communities that are the most vulnerable to the worst weather effects due to climate change, to the worst weather extremes due to climate change. And of course, we can think of Hurricane Katrina and Hurricane Sandy, and we can recall those images in the media to understand what we mean by that. We are talking about poor people, we are talking about people of color that due to their systemic exclusion, to their systemic marginalization, do not count on very rich networks of support. They don't count on services and resources that can alleviate their suffering. And worst of all, these are the communities where very bad things get cited, such as coal plants. And in the presentation before by Angela Tovar, we heard all that stuff that gets cited in that point, right? Like the waste management, like the this, like the that. Those very bad things, very bad for the environment and for people's health, normally get cited in our communities. So at the march, I also noticed that it was frontline communities that were quite literally at the lead of the march. And I like that. I like that not only were we, you know, the fact was highlighted that our communities are the most vulnerable, but that we were also put at the very front of the march. Because for me, that indicated the importance of placing our communities front and center in the development of solutions, problem solving, and above all, in including them in decisions that affect their lives directly. So I am very grateful for the opportunity to share with you this very inspiring story of how a frontline community, both from the perspective of being directly impacted and from the perspective of taking charge and leading the change, happened and continues to happen to this very day in very fruitful ways, right here in the state of Massachusetts, and like I said, in this very poor city in Western Massachusetts called Holyoke. And the story that I will share with you is a story of convergence. It is a story of convergence and synergy between big national environmental organizations and a small local community-based organization, between environment and labor. Oftentimes, the environmental organizations and laborers are at odds with each other, but in this story, we were able to bring the two together. And a story of convergence and synergy between addressing the very immediate concerns and connecting those immediate concerns with a long-term vision. So sometime in 2010, Sierra Club and Toxics Action Center approached Neighbor to Neighbor about closing the coal plant in Manton, Holyoke. And if you all know about this, but Sierra Club had this gigantic national campaign to close every single coal plant in the country. So they approached us about this one in Manton. And our lead organizer, very well trained in Neighbor to Neighbor's organizing model, that includes the base building and the alliance work or the coalition building work, agreed to explore this campaign as long as our members were involved and took the lead. She also invited other allies to join. And because of our economic justice lens and our historical partnership with labor, which again can often be at odds with environment, our organizer invited Jobs with Justice and other local unions. At the very first meeting that our members had with Sierra Club and Toxics Action Center, they learned about the dangers to people's health that burning coal causes, primarily to the respiratory system. And our members very quickly resonated with the story. Why? Because Holyoke actually has the highest asthma rates in the state. And as a matter of fact, our members were dealing with this issue, and one of them had such severe asthma that she would be hospitalized at least 2 times a year, okay? So again, connecting that health hazard and the health risk to the burning of the coal that was happening quite literally in the backyard was a very powerful way of activating this group of people. A campaign was born on that day that actively engaged our members and the community at large. And again, because of our economic justice lens, the campaign expanded its demands. It was not only going to be about closing the coal plant, it was also going to be about the workers that would inevitably be laid off once we were successful in closing down the plant. So the campaign included negotiating very generous severance and retirement benefits packages for the workers. And then finally, because of our voter engagement and our voter empowerment work, the campaign sought the support of local elected officials like the mayor of Holyoke, Holyoke City Council, and Holyoke's state and House representatives. And this kind of political backing was essential to counteract arguments that closing the plant would mean loss of jobs for the city of Holyoke. The campaign lasted 4 years. I don't have another, don't worry, I do have another slide. I forget. Okay, so the campaign lasted 4 years and our members got very busy, you know, with testimonies locally and at the State House, with press conferences and actions, organizing community forums and doing what we love the most, which is going door to door, you know, educating our their neighbors. And they also engaged, and this was one of the, for us, a neighbor to neighbor, it was one of the most innovative aspects of the campaign, which was to put direct pressure, you know, do direct actions and direct advocacy with the energy corporation that was running the coal plant. So here we see Vilma. That's Vilma, one of our member leaders, most likely talking to her state rep, doing a legislative visit at the State House. After we engaged in all of this, it was in May of last year that the Energy Corporation announced that they would close the coal plant. And indeed, in the fall of last year, Mount Tom burned coal no more. So here we have our members celebrating the victory. And here's another picture of them providing some testimony. This is at the council level. In the city of Holyoke. So this was great. People were happy. People were celebrating. Great victory. We have closed down a coal plant. We also won the severance packages for the workers. We were able to meet the two things, right? We were able to take care of the workers, and we were able to close down this plant that was generating these very harmful fumes that were endangering the lungs of our people. And in the process, we were part of reducing carbon emissions for the state of Massachusetts and the country. And as we saw in the prior presentation this morning, you know, these things just flow throughout the globe. So we did our part in reducing carbon emissions for all of us. But this was the thing, and this is what gets me into the stage two, that our members said, we're not done. We're not done. And then when we asked, well, what do you mean? And they said, well, what's going to happen to all that coal ash now? We need to figure out how to deal with the coal ash that has been left behind. And look at all that land. Look at all that land where that plant is now not operating. What are we going to do with all that land? And so the second stage of the campaign, it was born thanks to the very good questions that they were asking. And we moved into what we now call a just transition. That is, what do we do to move beyond coal? What do we do to move beyond all these energy sources that are causing all these harmful carbon emissions? What is at the other side? And our members are leading the way in what we are now calling this just transition phase. And I want to tell you that when we started, we began with two demands in the campaign. The first one was full cleanup of the site. Actually, three demands. The first one was cleanup of the site, full cleanup of the site. The second was advocating for greater reliance on renewable energy for the state of Massachusetts, with a particular focus on solar energy. And then finally, leading a community planning process very similar, most likely, to what you shared, Angela, which I was so glad to hear you, because I'm going to follow up with you. But leading a community planning process to repurpose the site where once that coal plant burned coal into something that would be good for both the environment and the economy. Because of the advocacy efforts that we led, State Representative Aaron Vega was able to move $100,000 to the city of Holyoke for us to conduct a feasibility study. And what the feasibility study looked for was a way to fully clean up the site and ideas, recommendations on what would be the best use of that land. Sadly, the findings came back, and the findings indicate that full cleanup of that site will not be possible, okay? There is over 40 feet of coal ash in the site. that moving would be way more harmful, okay? And not only that, even if you could move it, the question is, where would you put it? Where would you put it? And while we don't like that coal ash in our backyard, we also recognize that it's not fair to fight to move that coal ash to somebody else's backyard. So for us, the question is, now what? What do we do now? The study also indicates or argues that the coal ash is safely contained. But our members are not happy with that. They want to understand what does exactly that mean, to have that much debris be safely contained. And this is the wisdom of our members. They know that climate change is here, right now. And you will recall the presentations from this morning. It is almost certain that rains are going to increase for this part of the world, the Northeast. That, you know, we're gonna see more superstorms, that we're gonna see more torrential rains. And our members are asking very good questions. What will happen if the river overflows? What will happen if that containment is compromised? What will happen if that coal ash seeps into the water sources, okay? So these are very good questions for which we have no answer, and we are discovering that there is absolutely no legal framework, no statutes, no laws that can help the community in Holyoke be protected in the case of an environmental disaster should something like that come to pass. But that is not stopping us. Just because there's no legal framework, we have decided that we are going to fight, although it's an uphill battle, and we recognize that it's an uphill battle, to at least begin to set the precedent or at least have the conversations to move the country, the cities, the state into thinking that it's not enough about closing the coal plants, that we have to realize that there are consequences that go beyond the carbon emissions, that we right now don't know necessarily what the long-term consequences are going to be, and that we need to start thinking about those things right now. So in the case of Holyoke, should this happen, we do not know who we should hold accountable, and we believe that it was a growing awareness and a political movement that have opened our eyes to the harm caused by coal. And that political awareness and that movement created the conditions for Neighbor to Neighbor to win the campaign in Holyoke to close the coal plant. So we believe that it must be a similar political movement that will push for this legal framework that ensures a just transition to move beyond coal. We are not giving up, and we are going to start pressuring the Energy Corporation by demanding two things. One, siting a solar farm or garden in the place where that plant burned coal. And two, negotiating a multi-million community benefits agreement that will give the city of Holyoke enough resources to develop and implement a climate adaptation, a climate readiness, a climate emergency plan. Meanwhile, we have joined through our broad strategy, the Green Justice Coalition, and we are advocating for 20% reliance on renewable energy by the year 2025, including more solar projects, with a particular focus on community shared solar projects. And I'm gonna be going now my presentation. Thank you, Clark, for reminding me. I am going to then end with the last slide that I have here for you, because the work that we started in Holyoke is now spreading to our other chapters, and the next one is Worcester, being led by people like Gloria Ramirez, who is an indigenous woman from El Salvador. And in this picture, she's providing testimony at a legislative hearing earlier this year that was advocating for raising the net metering cap so that we can have more solar energy, so we can have more community share solar. And from that indigenous cosmology, a cosmology that deeply respects the earth, Gloria gave what I believe was the most powerful testimony that day. I'm gonna just give you a couple of quotes of her testimony. But Gloria said that, in a quote, "We are living in a crisis without precedent, stemming from the fact that our current society does not appreciate the interrelationship between nature and human beings." And I end the quote. I thank you for the opportunity to share with you the importance of taking into account frontline communities, both at those directly impacted by the effects of climate change and those who can and should play a starting role in solutions and decisions that must impact our lives. When frontline communities take center stage, all of us win. Thank you.
Elena, thank you very much. Our last speaker before we get to do a little Q&A and take your questions is Marcius Extavour, who is going to talk to us about a sort of late-breaking development, which is the Carbon XPrize, which in some sense impacts all the talks we've heard here. How do you really get to solving some of these problems on a high level, and then they can be implemented across the world? Marcius, take it away.
Thanks so much. My name is Marcius Extavour. I'm from an organization called XPRIZE. I think what the story I'd like to tell you about today that has in common with what we've heard so far on the panel from these speakers is it really is a way of illustrating the way that a small group of individuals who are passionate, who have a vision, and who are bold enough to execute on that vision and drive it forward can really have a massive impact in their own community, in their own lives, but also in the lives of people in their county, in their state, in their country, and actually around the world. What I'm going to talk specifically about today is the organization XPRIZE and what we do, the way we try to drive innovation, and then specifically speak about our latest XPRIZE competition, which is all about converting CO2, this climate change causing gas, this greenhouse gas, into a useful, valuable product. XPRIZE is an innovation engine. We try to work at the intersection of audacious and achievable. What does that mean? It means we try to identify grand challenges in the world, like a lot of people and a lot of groups out there, and among those, think which ones are stuck, which ones are really sticky and difficult because of some specific market failure. In other words, where is there a problem that really doesn't have a lot of incentive, the way a lot of people recognize it, to be solved? And if we can identify some of those, we say, is there a way to design and run an incentive prize competition? Create an incentive, in this case in dollars, and in technology development to say, hey, there's a problem out there. If you have a solution to this problem, we will pay you to solve it. We want to create a community of solvers, empower innovators out there, wherever they might be, to bring their best ideas and to showcase them for their peers and for the rest of the world around some of these really tough problems. One of our taglines is making the impossible possible. A bit of our history. XPRIZE is a 20-year-old organization now. On the left, you'll see at the top is the total prize purse we've awarded across all of our past competitions. And on the right, these are open and ongoing prizes. I'm not going to step through them in detail. I'll give a couple of examples before I talk about the carbon approach that we're taking, which is our latest XPRIZE competition. But I want to point out that we work in a variety of domains. We started in space exploration, and we continue that to this day. We also work in literacy. We have a prize for adult literacy, which is focused actually on US cities. Literacy defined more broadly, including a prize for literacy among children. We also work in health, and I'll speak about the Qualcomm Tricorder Prize in a moment. But this gives you a sense of where we have been and where we are today. What you see on the right, these are all open XPRIZE competitions that are running today. I said we work at the intersection of audacious and achievable. We go into domains where people don't necessarily see obvious solutions or where it's not even clear if solutions are possible and say, why not and what if? This is a photo of the BP blowout of the Macondo well in the Gulf of New Mexico. You might remember these scenes from television and other places. In response to this, XPRIZE launched an ocean cleanup challenge, an ocean oil cleanup challenge. It turns out the technology used for oil spill cleanup really hadn't changed in several decades. No one really thought it could be done much better than it had, including the major oil companies who are responsible for doing this cleanup. But a small group of individuals demonstrated, in this case, a technology that could clean up oil four times more efficiently, blowing away the benchmarks even we had audaciously set for teams. The way XPRIZE works is that we don't define solutions, we try to identify problems and create incentive competitions where individuals can bring their own ingenuity and passions to bear on these problems. Healthcare is another domain where we have an active prize competition. One of the challenges, as everyone knows, in healthcare is that it's expensive. Access is a problem. Medical diagnostics are not cheap, whether it's an MRI or an X-ray or even the care of a medical professional. So at XPRIZE, we said, why can't we put healthcare diagnosis in the palm of your hand? We've seen a smartphone revolution over the last few years. Why can't we put some of this diagnosis in the palm of your hand? And we created the Qualcomm Tricorder XPRIZE. This is all about home medical diagnostics, quick and easy diagnostics that you might imagine maybe even running on your smartphone. I know this is a scientifically oriented audience for a lot of us, and you might recognize that word tricorder if there are any Star Trek fans out there. This is a device from pure fantasy, science fiction. In Star Trek, the doctor waves it in front of the patient and says, you have glaucoma and two broken ribs. My thing says so. Well, with modern technology advances, we're moving in that direction. This prize is in its final stage. We expect to award this prize next year. And there's a handful of amazing teams from a lot of different places with different approaches to this kind of medical diagnosis. Quick, reliable, in your hand. Literacy and learning and education and access are also challenges we try to address. We know that there are over 1 billion people that are not literate in this world. And a lot of it is because they don't have access to the tools that we might enjoy in a country like the United States or Canada, where I'm from. We can build classrooms, we can build schools, we can train teachers, but is there a way to think about bringing a radical breakthrough into this space, even as we pursue these approaches? The Global Learning XPRIZE is a prize we've launched very recently, and this has the goal of bringing children in a few communities, in this case working that live and work in rural East Africa, up to a level of English literacy. They're between ages 6 to 9. So this is really about putting learning tools in the hands of families, in the hands of parents, and in the hands of children themselves. I use these examples to give you a flavor of the type of ambition we have at XPRIZE and the way that we try to unlock the spirit of innovation to really try and make a difference in some of these really tricky problems. Energy is the problem I want to focus on today. We've heard a lot of talk about energy today, and we've heard a lot of talk about climate. Waleed mentioned the idea of bringing perspective, visual perspective, temporal perspective, and I think that's an approach I really believe in as well. This is just a photograph that illustrates part of the Earth lit from space. But the point I want to emphasize here is that we know that even as demand for energy grows, transportation, electricity, the part of the infrastructure of the way we live and our lifestyles, we know that the markets that deliver energy to us are going to favor the lowest cost solutions. And the lowest cost solutions are not necessarily the solutions that are most responsible from a climate perspective. I think this audience knows that. To put that into a bit more technical perspective, I want to explicitly make the link between our climate challenge and our energy challenge. This is a technical plot. It shows you where the greenhouse gases in our world come from. And energy, by far, is the largest slice. So to a certain extent, the climate problem is the energy problem. They're two sides of the same coin. This is another way of carving up the same data. This just breaks down carbon dioxide in particular and shows that, yeah, electricity and heat, that black roughly 40% of the pie chart, this is really a massive source of emissions, specifically carbon dioxide emissions. So what can we do about this? What would a radical breakthrough in this domain look like? It might mean a radical shrinking of that black slice of the pie, for instance, or dramatically reducing the CO2 emissions. There are a lot of approaches to reducing CO2 emissions, but we've identified one that we think is underinvested and is maybe a missing piece in the CO2, the suite of CO2 addressing problems or solutions that can address CO2. CO2 is primarily viewed as a waste. It's definitely a greenhouse gas. We've heard all about its effects on climate. But it's viewed primarily as a waste. We send it up stacks that look like this. It ends up in our atmosphere. It ends up in our oceans. It ends up everywhere. But is there another way to think about it? A fun exercise I like to do is to just look around the room and think, wait a minute, many of the materials we use every day, the polyester in my suit, the seats we're sitting in, these plastic chairs, the building materials this structure is made of, these are actually all carbon-based compounds. So is there a way to reimagine using carbon dioxide as actually an input, as a way of building out the natural world, and at the same time using some of this excess CO2, which we know is contributing to our climate problem? This is what the NRG COSIA Carbon XPrize is all about. This prize was launched about 6 weeks ago. We've had tremendous response from groups, individuals, teams, small companies, businesses all over the world who are sending me questions, touching our website, indicating their interest to participate somehow and maybe get a piece of this and bring their solution to bear. So let me tell you what it's all about. It's a $20 million prize, a global competition to bring the best ideas, the best innovators forward, the best teams, to demonstrate that they can convert the most carbon dioxide into products with the most net value. We don't care what you produce. We don't care how you produce it, as long as you can use CO2 and you can demonstrate you can convert it into something else. I just want to emphasize that this prize is about conversion. You may have heard about carbon capture and storage. This is also an extremely promising approach. What this prize does a little bit differently is focus on conversion, not just capturing CO2 from a waste stream, but turning it into a useful and valuable product. Now, I am a scientist, and my wife's a chemistry teacher, and she would kill me if I didn't go through this talk without including one chemistry slide. I brought a little toy with me. It's a bit small. You may not be able to see it. But this is a little toy model of a CO2 molecule. Two O's in red and one C in black in the middle. At a technical level, what we're talking about is breaking up this molecule and turning it into something else. The nice thing about these toys is, you know, it's a piece of cake to just pull off one of these oxygen atoms and maybe get rid of it and imagine using this carbon atom to do something, anything. Make a fuel, make a drug, make a building material. But it turns out that chemically, scientifically, technically, this is very difficult to do. It's an ambitious challenge, but we know that it's doable. We know that it's achievable. I don't want you to focus too much on the details of this cartoon. It's actually from an article in Nature about this space, the idea of converting CO2, and this prize in particular, which is just from a couple of weeks ago. On the left-hand side is the simple carbon dioxide molecule. So at a technical level, what we're talking about is rearranging the atoms in that molecule into some other formation. As you move from the far side of the screen on your left over to the right, you can see that the cartoon slowly changes as different atoms, in this case hydrogens, are added, some oxygens are taken away. And underneath, these are the common chemical names we give to these things: formic acid, formaldehyde, methanol, methane. Now, unless you're a chemist, this might not get you very excited, but these are actually the building blocks of most of the things we see in this room. The carpets, the clothing, the plastics, the drugs, the fuels. In this way, we know that a lot of things can be made from CO2, and this challenge is all about unlocking that innovation to see how far we can push it. I think one of the most exciting things about an XPRIZE that has just been launched, like this one, is we don't know what the solutions are going to look like. We don't know which teams are going to participate. We don't know which ideas people are going to bring to bear to this problem. But we do know about some people that are working in this space. And I want to give you a couple of examples of what approaches that people are trying today, just to sort of give you a visual sense of what some of these teams may look like 3-4 years from now, when we're in the final stage of this competition, and we've got teams building out real technologies right next to a power station, using the CO2 coming from their flue gases to make valuable products. This is a photo from Iceland. There's a group called Carbon Recycling, and they're making a chemical. In this case, it's methanol, in a facility that looks like this. Now, I mean, this is sort of a dream for an engineer. To the average person, it just looks like another industrial facility. What's so fascinating about this is that it's powered by geothermal energy. And again, to focus on the innovators and the people doing the work, here they are up front giving a tour to some guests at this facility. Another approach to conversion of CO2 and to addressing the CO2 problem, this is actually an artist's rendition of another approach. This is actually an approach meant to take CO2 either out of flue gas, which is what we call the output of power plants and industry, or sucking it directly out of the air. This is a giant wall of fans. Again, an artist's rendition, so far, something out of science fiction. But there is a team called Carbon Engineering that's working hard on this concept. I bring these two examples up to give you a flavor that there are a lot of ideas out there that are being tried. The beauty of the XPRIZE context is that we have an opportunity to showcase these innovators, tell their stories, let them tell their stories, and give them an opportunity to show how far they can push this idea of converting CO2 into valuable products. Our broad goals are not just in technology demonstration, but in resetting and reframing the conversation to show that there are positive technology solutions. We try hard and we think hard about them and we provide a safe space to try these new ideas, we can unlock the power of innovation to see a new way forward. So what we hope to achieve with the NRG COSIA Carbon XPRIZE is really to incentivize innovators to bring their best ideas forward and to demonstrate what's possible. And we hope to do this while not just addressing the climate change challenge, but also recognizing that there's an opportunity to build a bridge to a clean energy future at the same time. With that, I'd like to stop and thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to be here. I look forward to the discussion, and thanks to my fellow panelists. You guys are inspiring. I'll end it there. For more information, you know where to find me, but you can also visit our website, carbon.xprize.org. Thanks very much.
We're going to bring up all the speakers back on stage. If you have questions, be thinking about them. We are going to take them, I think. Do we have a mic coming around? OK, fantastic. Excellent. So let me just kick it off here with a couple of questions. So Adam, Angela, you talked about this idea of really cities taking the lead. But I want to come back to that issue I brought up. I remember in the wake of Hurricane Sandy, people saying, okay, well, you know, we may have to, I mean, if sea levels rise a lot, we may have to put in seawalls. But what seawalls do is they protect one place, which means a whole bunch of water is going somewhere else. Do we, even if it's painful at some point, have to make choices about, like, this part of the city people can't live in anymore? I mean, is that sort of the real truth of the matter, even if nobody's talking about it? Either of you can take that.
That was part of the discussions pre-Sandy when we were trying to engage the community around climate change. And I have to note, we did 5 roundtables around the city trying to get communities to talk about climate adaptation. This is back in 2008. The Point hosted our first one. But the conversation then, I imagine, was very different than the conversation you had after Sandy, because people just hadn't been focusing on it. You know, the challenge with New York particularly, 520 miles of coastline, very varied. We have 14 miles of beaches. People actually can go surfing on the Rockaways. We have Wall Street. We have subways. All of our power plants are on the waterfront, so you can get liquid fuels there because it's more efficient to bring them in by barge. All of our marine transfer stations are there for solid waste, so we can get them up by barge rather than having to have trucks go throughout the communities. All of our wastewater treatment plants are on the water because it's a gravity-fed system. So we have an enormous amount of infrastructure that's there. New Yorkers' carbon footprint is 1/3 of the national average because we're an ultra-dense environment. So it's a climate solution to live in a city. So we always thought there was no one-size-fits-all strategy to sea level rise, to coastal storms. A lot of people pushed to have a massive seawall, would have had 2 movable pieces, each the size of the Eiffel Tower. They said it would only cost $30 billion, which we said you've never heard of prevailing wages in New York or tried to do work here. That's probably $60 billion and double the time you think it will take to get made. And there were communities outside of it, New Jersey, Long Island, that would have been outside of the barrier. And making a choice saying these people are protected, those aren't, was not something we were comfortable making on such a huge long-term investment. We were investing in soft infrastructure, green infrastructure, distributed systems, so you have a small barrier in some places. You can do beach berms in others. You can have wetlands. We have 6,000 miles of wetlands throughout New York. And there are some areas you want to think about your building codes. You know, throughout history, we've safely and responsibly lived in floodplains. You have to be aware of what the risk is. Yeah. You have to build around it and think about how that works and doing things around evacuation.
Angela, do you think there is fear that if climate change turns out to be, you know, there's always this range of predictions, but if it's the upper end of the range, really tough decisions will have to be made that nobody sort of wants to talk about right now?
Yeah, I mean, I guess just going back to this idea that, you know, some areas are protected over the other areas, I think that's why we have to start thinking more comprehensively, right? I mean, if you even think about the example that I gave, Rebuild by Design was only looking at the markets, right, the Hunts Point food markets, and that's a very small piece of a larger industrial waterfront. And I think that that's why we took a step back as an organization. And even though we don't have all of the resources and the funding to make this comprehensive plan happen right now, we have to start reminding people that there is this huge industrial waterfront and that we can't just build what people value as the priority on the waterfront, which is the food market, when there are people living on the waterfront, when there are other businesses on the waterfront, when there are people working on the waterfront, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's why we're pushing back a little bit and saying we need to do this in a more comprehensive manner. We have to do this in a manner that doesn't prioritize what you value over what I value. Mm-hmm. And we really have to take this approach where we're looking at this in a much broader way.
Let me take a question out here if there is one. Raise your hand if you've got a question. One right here.
So predictions show us that if Greenland melts, it's 7 meters on the ocean, which is like 28 feet or something, and then the Antarctic ice sheets could add another 50 or 80 feet to that. Did anybody do any analysis in New York as to how much would even be, that you could even imagine planning for without just abandoning the place and letting the Central Park turn into a coral reef?
Right.
So we actually did projections out to 2100, and this was back in 2009 before the IPCC came out and said that they had underestimated their projections. We did what we called a rapid ice melt scenario, where we said if some of those things happen, what would that mean for New York? Up to 2100, which was, you know, cities and political leaders typically plan in 4 years. We were trying to plan in a 30-year time scale for Plan YC or 20-year time scale, but also wanted to have our eyes on what does it mean for 2100, because the choices we're making in building a power plant, that's going to last for 50 or 60 years. Under the extreme projections for sea level rise, there were a few parts of the city that were permanently flooded at that time. That wasn't looking at the 28 feet of water, whatever it may be. That changes it, definitely. But there's a longer time horizon to think about how do you look at those investments and what you reinvest in over time. You don't have to evacuate a community today because 50 years from now you might be facing sea level rise. You want to think about, do you build a power plant there? Do you invest in new public housing there? Do you extend a subway line there? Or how do you gradually over time think about where your infrastructure is placed? But you have a natural time horizon with your infrastructure to think about that planning and relocation. You don't have to do it all at once.
At that time, it was like a meter they were talking about,
our
probably in 100 years.
Our
right?
High end was 2 meters.
Yeah, yep. Okay.
Marcius, I am guessing you do a lot of traveling and thinking about different sort of solutions to the issue of having a lot of carbon in the atmosphere. And I'm wondering, did the XPRIZE come about in this idea of carbon conversion because other options for clean energy seemed to you like they didn't have as much potential? I mean, I was just at MTech at MIT talking about emerging technologies, and there was a fair amount of talk about, for example, a new kind of nuclear energy which uses the spent fuel that already exists in places like Yucca Mountain and essentially makes it a lot less radioactive by using, you know, so there's a lot of battery technology being talked about. Did this seem to you like, no, this is it, this has the most promise?
You know, that's a great question, and I appreciate that one. It's true that I do get the opportunity to check out a lot of different approaches, but what we're trying to say by launching this XPRIZE is not, this is the solution. We think this can be part of the solution. In fact, we don't think particularly, and I don't think we're alone in this, in thinking there is not a silver bullet solution. No. So we think zero carbon energy is fantastic. We think carbon capture and storage is fantastic. We think nuclear, if we can solve the problems, are fantastic. Renewables, great. But what we tried to do is say, look, this is also a promising tool. We think it can have a role to play. And it looks like it hasn't got the attention that it deserves. It could be a game changer. We really don't know how much of an impact it can have. We have some ideas, and we're excited about it. So we're not trying to say this is the solution, but we think it can be part of the low carbon or zero carbon solution.
Is there another question out there, right there in the back?
In 2011, the IPCC had a chapter on removing carbon and making products out of it. And the total was relatively small, it turned out. Not that it's a bad idea, we shouldn't do it, but it's a relatively small amount. If you look at everything we make from petroleum today, which is the big source of carbon-based technology, carbon fibers, plastics, everything, you know, it's about 10% of the total petroleum that's produced every year. So that gives you kind of a range of what could be accomplished. And so that seems to me to be, it's a reasonable, you know, it's a good thing. If we could do 10%, it would be wonderful. If we could remove 10% of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. As the Carbon Prize thought about what is the only really large-scale way, super large-scale way to bring carbon out of the atmosphere, which is by mobilizing the biosphere. About 30% of the carbon in the atmosphere came from soils. Restoring that back into soils would be a wonderful thing and would be highly productive in terms of agriculture and other things. More productive wetlands means more productive fish in the ocean, what we heard the problem in the previous one. Is there going to be an XPRIZE that would address creative ways of using the biosphere to remove carbon from the atmosphere?
Thank you for the question. I think creative ways is the key phrase in your question, the way I see it. Actually, those ways you both described, replacing petroleum-based products with carbon, CO2-based products, and replacing CO2 in soils, both of those are actually eligible for this prize. We don't care what product you make. If you make a soil that is based on CO2, you're in. If you can replace something that's made from oil, you're in. If you can replace something that is not made from oil, for instance, cement, or a building material, or a drug, or something that's made from natural gas. The technical way we're scoring this is, what is the mass of CO2 you have been able to replace or actually convert from the flue gas? And what is the value, the net value, of that thing? In other words, what's its market size? Is there a lot of it used or a little of it used? And what were the costs of your inputs? How much energy did you spend to make it? So it's really a free-for-all. And you know, just on the point of the biosphere, we're very excited about some teams that are using enzymatic approaches, bacteria, algae. These are actually the original critters that figured out how to convert CO2. Mm-hmm. This is also eligible. If they can turn it into something that demonstrates value and scale, they're more than welcome.
And what's the time frame to get it
this time? 4 years.
4 years.
It's 4.5 years total. We're 7 weeks into it.
Okay.
So I'll say 4 years to be conservative. But we're aiming to award this prize at the late winter of 2020.
Okay. Thank you.
Elena, a question for you. We've talked so much about sort of cities as our central focus here. And you talked about this idea of having all this coal ash and where do you put it and not wanting to put it in somebody else's backyard because you know what a pain it is to have in your backyard. Is there a concern that as cities increasingly turn into the places where people move and people want to be and where there's focus and where there's urban planning and you know where there's sustainability officers, that the way we get electricity, the coal plants and stuff, are put out in the countryside so that that way at least nobody has to run into them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that for us, the most interesting aspect of where we are right now is realizing how little a thought has been put into what happens once we close these plants and in the event that we cannot fully clean them, which will appear to be the case.
Mm-hmm.
We don't think it's fair, you know, to engage in not in my backyard debates. So we are actually exploring what could be an answer that feels a fair answer for us and for other people involved, and that begins to pave the way for a legal framework, you know, that protects communities in what is right now actually unknown. Because it's very common for us as human beings to deal with the very immediate, and right now the very immediate is close the plant,
right.
Reduce carbon emissions, you know, do these competitions. But we don't know, like, the actions that we're doing today, what are the consequences of those actions today in the future going forward. So I don't really have a good answer for your question, except that we are in it right now. Mm-hmm. And realizing that just asking those questions right now is good enough for now.
Right.
And then and engaging in the process of figuring out, you know, the answers
right.
to those.
Comes back to that whole sort of long-term planning. If they had done that 50, 60 years ago and that coal plant opened, you might not be where you are today.
Right, but you know, the coal plant operated legally.
Right, right.
There's nothing that we can do to the coal. I mean, we're going to try to appeal, you know, to the, I think one of the presenters in the morning talked about the moral imperative of climate change. We feel that the climate change literally changes everything, and that we don't have a legal framework that is addressing the new reality of climate change. Mm-hmm. And so that we need to start developing the legal framework. So again, the coal plant operated legally. Mm-hmm. They never violated any laws. They have absolutely no, you know, reason why they would have to meet our demands, except if they join, if they play a leadership role, if they're a corporate leader in terms of, you know, just that moral piece. Mm-hmm. So we don't know we're going to be ending up with this, but we're going to try.
Anja, Elena, Adam, Marcus, we could easily talk for another half hour here. Thank you so much. This was great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we'll take a few minutes break and then be back in about 15 minutes.